presented by John Quinn.
Welcome. This week, a return visit by a man whose thoughts and words electrify the airwaves each time we hear him. John O'Donoghue, the author of the best-selling Anam Chara, Spiritual Wisdom from the Celtic World. A large section of John O'Donoghue's book, Anam Chara, deals with the positivity and the possibilities that are open to us as we grow older.
One of the amazing lines out of the Bible that I really like is a line from the prophet Haggai, who says, "You have sown so much and harvested so little." And I feel that old age and aging is a time of great gathering, a time of sifting, and a time of reaping the rewards of forgotten and neglected experience. And that it's important to say that this is possible for everyone. Contemporary society worships youth, it worships strength, it worships image. It has a whole ideology of externality, and it has no refined sense of the subtlety of soul, the secrecy of the heart, and especially it has no sensitivity of these interim regions where the great gatherings happen in human life. Now, admittedly, old age is a very difficult time. And I mean, I can't talk about it from within because I still have an old bit of youth in me. But it's a time when the body becomes more infirm, when you could be ill, when you could be alone. And it's also a time maybe when you become dependent. And you know, when you'd walk down the street now and you'd see an old person, an old man or an old woman, and they'd be walking slow, like you'd kind of go beside them and then you'd overtake them and you'd walk on, you know. But the achievement that you wouldn't notice of that person being out on their own on the street looking for what they need, we'll say, shopping or whatever, and being able to come back home, like I'd say when an old person goes for a day out or for something like that, that they come back home and they kind of recover from it, and it's almost a celebration. You know, it reminds me of the great Polish film director, Kieslowski, who did the Ten Commandments and Three Colors, Blue, White and Red. Always in the films that I've seen from him, there's always a crucial moment in the evolution of the plot when an old man or an old woman, anonymous figures, just pass by and the camera lingers on them. Almost like an oracle or a gnomon of the future of time for these characters who are in the midst of great passion and trying to work something out. So there's that negative side to old age. What I think is that that has to do with the externality, it has to do with the body. And my understanding of old age and aging is that as the body diminishes, the soul gets richer and stilled. Because in old age, one of the things you have, whatever way you want to construct it, is you have time. And when you have time, your soul begins to decipher things more and more. Like Camus said, after one day in the world, we could live the rest of our life in solitary confinement, because so much happens to us in one day. And if you look at that in the perspective of all of one's life, I mean, there are literally thousands of years of experience packed in to 60 or 70 years of human life. Like, because the amazing thing about the human mind is, it is never neutral. The amazing thing about the human soul and the human spirit is it is never in a state of non-experience. Like, there's some bloody thing going on all the time, even when you're sleeping. Like, there's big rivers of dream thought flowing through the earth of your body, like bringing up all kinds of mythic archetypal stuff, some of which belongs to you and a lot of which belongs to the clay and a lot of which belongs to the race. So there's so much. Like, a human being is a kind of endless epic theatre of activity. So in old age, the time slows a bit, the outer draw to activity recedes, and you have time for the more contemplative side of things. So I think old age is when one enters the contemplative side of one's own life, and that you have a chance then to decipher what has happened to you, to see the hidden depth of experiences that has occurred in your life, and you really have a chance almost, you know, to weave a new shelter for yourself. I love the image of the Carthusian monks, the contemplatives, who wear this habit with the cowl on it. And that then is actually sewn up when they die. And that becomes, if you like, the shroud in which they're laid out. And I would look at old age in a positive way as a time of weaving the eternal shroud, the things that you take with you into the eternal world. I remember one time in my column having a sermon about, you know, that we shouldn't get waylaid and mislaid, and our journey shouldn't get falsified in the world, trying to carry the world on our shoulders, and because we can take nothing with us when we die. And I was up in the local shop afterwards, and one of the neighbours said to me that he liked the sermon or whatever, and he said, "Do you know the way we just say that around here?" And I said, "No." And he said, "You'd never see a trailer after a hearse." And you wouldn't, like, and you can take nothing with you but the interior things that have reached a level of refinement that there is no barrier anymore for them to pass through. So I think that in that sense, that old age and aging is the ultimate refinement and the ultimate harvest. And like, our culture has gone so really into falsity that we don't acknowledge that at all. Like, it's very interesting if you look at the anthropology of tribal cultures, that the elders were always the people of wisdom, you know. We put them away in old people's homes. And like in old people's homes, some people have to put their, you know, when an old person, that they can't be managed, and they have to be put into an old people's homes. And like, I'll tell you now, some of the loneliest places I've ever been have been old people's homes, you know. I remember one particular place I used to go into to see people. And when you'd go in, like 20 little worn, winnowed faces with hungry eyes would look up at you as if you might be the visitor that they've expected maybe for months, or maybe in some cases for years. And like, it used to take me a couple of days to recover from it, because it's just so lonesome. Like. And I think that it's lovely to have a friendship with an old person, because I think you learn so much from them. The Bible says somewhere that you should always ask for advice from a wise person. And old age and wisdom usually go together, because when you've been through the treadmill of experience, you know what counts. You know the chaff, like, from the real grain that brings nourishment. And I think that old people have great wisdom and great light, and that when they're not governed by fear, that there's incredible permission in them. And you'd often get more encouragement in relation to your own wildness and your own old sense of danger and carelessness from an old person than you would from anyone who's stuck in the middle of a system or a role or the kind of atrophied complacency that often passes for achievement and respectability.
And of course the other great asset that growing older brings with it is memory, which you put great store on, as where, if you like, the past is literally buried.
That's right. Well, one of the things since I was a child, like, that has always kind of haunted me is the way everything passes away, do you know? And I suppose in relation to death, like, you see then that's the ultimate transience, when somebody that you love goes away, falls out of visibility into the invisibility of death. And one of the things that has always kind of fascinated me is there a place where our vanished days secretly gather? I think there is. And I think the name of that place is memory. And that one of the fascinating things about old people is the way that they stay around the well of memory. And if you're willing to sit with them, you won't get analytical sentences about was it this or was it that, or could the meaning have been 1, 2, 3. What you'll get is always narrative about events from their childhood, which are never straight replications of what happened, but are the bones of the event enfleshed with image and with anecdote and with narrative. And I think that's absolutely fascinating. And I think that in a strange way, that nothing is ever lost or forgotten, and that everything that befalls us remains within us. So that there is literally within you the presence, in a refined sense, of everything that has ever happened to you. And that if you go looking for it, that you'll find it. I feel that in our time that memory has been hijacked by the computer industry, and that the more correct term there is recall rather than memory, because memory is a particularly intimate and sacramental human phenomenon. and there is a great depth and density to everyone. The image in nature that's really profound in relation to that is the tree, all the rings of memory that enfold all the years of growing, blossoming, dying, budding, blossoming, growing, dying, and enfolds all the elements of experience. And I feel in a similar way that within the clay part of each soul, that the rings of memory are there and that you can find them. And it's important to say too that a lot of the experiences that we have in the world are torn, broken, hard experiences. And in broken, difficult, lonesome experiences, you earn a quality of light that's very precious. I often think of it as quarried light. And when you come through a phase of pain or isolation or suffering, the light that's given to you at the end of that is a very precious light. And really, when you go into something similar again, it's the only kind of light that can mind you. It's the lantern that will bring you through it. And I feel that one of our difficulties in contemporary culture is this massive amnesia, that we forget so much. We forget so much because we're addicted to the instant and the moment. And that if sad, difficult things have happened to you, and if you've earned quarried, buried light, that again and again, you should visit that light. And almost like the light around the tabernacle, which signals the presence, you should allow that light to come round you, to awaken the presence that's in you, to calm you, to bring you contentment, and as well to give you courage. Because I think when a person is aging, that one of the things they really need is courage. I love the word careless. Like, the only way people would say, well, he's a careless kind of an individual. In one sense, that can mean that there's no responsibility in him. In its literal sense, it can mean that he's careless, that there is no false burdens of care on him, and that when he comes to the threshold of an experience, that he enters it with full availability, full courage and full wildness. And to be lovely in old age as the body sheds its power, if each of us who will be pilgrims into that time could shed false gravity and the weight that we carry a lot of our lives, and if we could enter our old age almost like a baby enters childhood, with the same kind of gracefulness of possibility and the same kind of innocence, but a second innocence rather than a first one.
But I suppose the problem is when you mention that so many people as they grow older tend not to do that there's a danger of opening up old sores and opening up old wounds, and you suggest to people that they should really be nice to themselves and treat themselves with tenderness.
I do. I think that there's great wisdom in the mystical tradition and in the Catholic tradition, and I feel that the old Catholic tradition always recognized that every contemplative needs ritual to make their way through the deserts of solitude. That in other words, if you sit down in an Arab chair by the fire or by the heater, and you allow the days like big, empty, grey rooms to come around your head, you'll turn and you'll feed on your own negativity. Contemplatives survive because the day is divided into times of praise, prayer, ritual. And in order to survive solitude, one needs ritual. And I think that there is no kind of education for getting old, really. I think you get old, you begin to lose your power, suddenly you find that you're left with it, you're on your own with it, and sees it like you do. And I think that there's so much that could be done to make people aware of the possibilities that are in old age. I think old age, like illness, is a time where you really need to mind yourself. And if you get hooked on some of the down pulls of gravity that are in your soul, it can be a time of torture that you pray for release, and to die would be total peace. Whereas I think if you look on it as a time of possibility, amazing things can happen. I think that a good old axiom always in life is to try to see the possibilities in a situation. Often in a situation, 'tis the walls we see, 'tis the doors where the key has been thrown away that we see. And we never see the windows of possibility and the places where thoughts and feelings can grow. And I think that in old age, there's a lot more time, and freedom comes with that. And I think in old age that one can totally reorientate one's life and find fascinating companionship with one's own soul.
You make the interesting point that how you view your future actually shapes it, and, yeah. And that really the important time is the now time.
Yes. Well, I believe that time isn't like space at all. Like, when you think of space now, if you think of Connemara, like, you see the mountains stretching out like with no walls at all, like as John Moriarty says, Connemara consciousness, like, God bless John. But like, and if you look down at Clare, you see the little fields and all that, and you see the space stretching out towards the mountain, towards the ocean. We falsely think that time is like that too, and that you walk through a field of a day and you cross over to the field of tomorrow and then to the field of the day after that. But it's not like that. Time comes towards us unshapen predominantly, and it's our expectation that shapes the time that's coming. So expectation creates the future. And if you bring creative expectation to your future, no matter what difficulty may lie in wait for you, you'll be able to somehow transfigure it. Whereas if you bring really negative expectation to your future, you'll turn yourself totally into a kind of tower of misery. It's amazing, actually, when people are in limit threshold situations, the resources that they can call on, which they would have been never before aware of until it really gets very, very difficult. Nor Hagenson crew at a thorn, as they say in Connemara, when the pressure comes on you. And I think that I think there's a great wisdom in perspective and in distance. It's usually when we're myopic and when we're close right up to a thing and we can't see its contour at all that it totally imprisons and controls us. Whereas sometimes if you step back, you get another view and you pick up a way of relating to the event or situation which frees you predominantly. One of the most beautiful films that I've ever seen is a film by a Japanese director. I'm not sure if it's Kurosawa now, but it's called Derezu Usala. And it's a story about a platoon of Russian soldiers who go in to map an area in Outer Mongolia. And the leader of the troop is a very elegant, dignified, intellectual man. And he comes across an old Mongolian man who's a very wise man. And this amazing friendship builds between the two men, the younger man and the older man, which is a classical theme in literature anyway, the mentor and the kind of disciple. And they get very close. The young man is learning so much from the older man, and they're deepening this amazing spiritual friendship. But what the young man doesn't realize, actually, that his passion, his sense of life and curiosity is enabling the old man to prepare for his dying. And there's one famous moment in the film when the old man suddenly sees a tiger. And it's a moment of pure dark epiphany. And you know in that moment that he knows he's going to die. And the rest of the film just fills out the moment then. But it's an amazing film about a way of ritualizing one's leave-taking of the world with dignity, with courage, with a great peacefulness, and as well with the sense of what you're actually leaving behind to those that you love.
So in fact, age doesn't really depend on time at all, but more so on temperament. I mean, you give the example that you can be old at 19. If you tell me the anecdote about the fellow was going to the pub, but it was going in the other direction. He was going into the other village to get back to the pub.
That's right. No, that was a story that my brother told me about. Like near us at home, there's a pub in one area, but you'd never get a lift if you were going towards the pub. Like, you have to go to a little village in order to get back. So he was passing one evening, driving home, and he passed this man who was going in the direction he was driving. He said, "Will you sit in, John?" And John said, "No, even though I'm walking this way," he said, "I'm going the other way." And I often thought that was a good old story, like, for so much of the false direction that masquerades as power and as achievement in contemporary culture. I feel that a lot of that is misdirected, and that we need to steady ourselves and have a look at where we actually are. But I really do believe that age depends on temperament, like you say, you've phrased it very nicely, that it depends on temperament rather than time. I mean, I know people of 26 and 27 that are literally in their the gravity that's around them, the seriousness, the lack of any little bit of spring or wildness in them, that are actually about 90. I know people of 70, 80, and even 85 and 6, like, who have the minds of 17-year-olds, have never bloody well managed to get old at all. For some strange reason, I think, the passionate heart never ages. And if you can keep your eros and your passion alive, then in some subtle, inevitable way, you're already in the old eternal world.
You mentioned in passing, you mentioned a couple of times the word solitude, which may or may not be a feature of old age, but it is a gift, as you see it, and it is not necessarily to be equated with loneliness.
No, I don't think it is. I actually think that it's impossible for a human to be lonely. I know that sounds absolutely crazy now. But the example I'd give is that when I left Connemara and lived in Germany for 4.5 years, I was a bit shocked first, like, because I knew Connemara very well and I was very close to the humans there. And suddenly, like, when I was in Germany in an old apartment in my own, it was utterly solitary. Like. And there's no place to, if you want to get away from humans, like, and you want to be really on your own, Germany is a great place to go, because these people don't bother you at all. Like, if they're going to come to see you, they'll ring up beforehand. And what struck me was the dual nature of the mind, the inner companionship of yourself. Like when you say hello to someone, you're breaking in a conversation they're always having with themselves. So we're always actually in permanent dialogue with ourselves. And therefore, solitude is a very rich time. It's the purification of that dialogue. I think what happens in loneliness is that we panic, that we somehow see ourselves as isolated and distant from others, and then that we really feel abandoned. And like there are a lot of people very lonely because they are literally abandoned. Nobody cares about them. And that's really, really lonely. There are a lot of other people who are really in relationship, in connection, they're cared for and they're loved, and they still feel lonely. And that is, I believe, their own responsibility and is in somehow a misperception almost. That's something that they feel self-pity or they feel kind of obsessed with themselves. Whereas if they let the rhythm of their solitude run and trusted it, they would be grand. I also think that, and I've learned this myself painfully too, that you can only relate to someone if you somehow have the courage and the need, I suppose, to inhabit your own solitude. I think you can only relate after your separateness. Like, otherwise, you're just using the other person to shield you from your own solitude. I think one of the things about old age is that it puts you really right into confrontation with that possibility, opens it up to you, and calls on you to trust and to honor the old eternal thing that maybe has been sleeping within you.
But what you're saying also is it's a time of great freedom and a time to shed a lot of burdens and not to be, again, as you mentioned earlier, not to be feeling regrets.
Yeah, I think it is a time of great freedom because I think that one of the things that militates against freedom for most humans is the weight of responsibility, all they have to do, and their constant obsession with the project and with the project of life. And if there are people depending on you, you've made your responsibility, you're on the go all the time. You've a whole barrage of expectation coming towards you. You're part of a system or a network where it's coming towards you as well. And like, you've so little space and so little free time for who you really are, for what you'd really love to do, and for what really deeply concerns you. That's why an awful lot of people in contemporary culture postpone their real lives until they retire. Like, they work like hell to get everything worked out and everything achieved, and then they believe that when they've got that done, that then they will have time to enjoy. And some of them actually achieve it. But sometimes if you get into that habit so deeply, you become what you do, and even when you have the time, you're not actually able to enjoy it. But I think ideally that old age can be a time of great liberation and great freedom. And it's a time when a lot of the old social mystification and mythology calms down. and you return to the essence of things. I think it's not accidental that the body is pared down in old age, because it's part of the process, the creative process. Like if you're writing something, you're writing a poem, you might have 50 versions of the poem, and ultimately you might end up with 7 or 8 lines, like after maybe having written 1600 lines, that then the distilled essence comes out. I think in old age, with the paring down of the body, the paring down of social connection, and the paring down of mobility, that it's a chance for the distilled essence to actually show itself. And you'd often glimpse that distillation in the faces or the eyes of old people. Like I think old people, to put it in another way, I think that old age is the time of theatre, and that very often the old body is the ultimate actor's disguise, and that inside that old body there is pure distilled essence, and it's a gracious sacramental moment when you meet it.
You quote, I think, Kavanagh, what the actual origin of it was, but what you're saying just now about so many people spend their lives preparing to live their lives rather than living it.
That's right. We said somewhere that we were taught to prepare for life rather than living it. And I think that that maybe that's the primary intention of all holiness, spirituality, and love, to free us for our lives. Gabriel Garcia Marquez said somewhere that to live is an art, and no sooner have we begun to learn it than it's already time for us to be departing. And I think that there are people now, this moment, like as we're talking here and people are listening to this interview, that there are people confronted with their leave-taking, like they'll be going out of the world in an hour, in a week or whatever, and they'd give anything to have another week or a month or a year, and they won't have it. And here are we, even if we're old, like, we still have time, and time is always full of possibility. So to be really a great gift that an old person could give to themselves would be the gift of recognizing the possibilities that are in their time, and to use the imagination. I mean, I always think that imagination is the gateway to a full life. And people who awaken their imagination, they come in to a force field of possibility, and there are doors opening everywhere. And I think that 'tis unknown what you can do if you begin to see it. But so often we allow the image that other people has of us to stop us from entering our lives, and we become literally what they want. I think in old age, you're kind of gone beyond that. Like, their attitude more or less towards you is to start and take care of you or whatever. And I think you've wild permission. I think that old people could become very subversive and very fascinating if they actually claimed the possibilities that they had, and if they talked out a bit more, like, and said what they feel, and didn't stand back and let the so-called young people, the yuppies and the entrepreneurs, run the whole show. Like, old people have far more fascinating things to say than an awful lot of what passes for wisdom in contemporary culture. And it would be lovely to hear them speak, you know.
John O'Donoghue on Growing Old. That topic and a lot more are featured in his wonderful book, Onam Chora, published by Bantam Press at £15 sterling.